Hey, welcome to Rise Church. Thanks so much for joining us online today. We believe that Jesus wants to do so much for you and through you, and we'd love to hear how he's working in your life. Please take a second to email your story to stories@rise-church.com. We hope you leave today feeling encouraged and uplifted. Enjoy the message.
And so today we are in a series called God Is. And this morning, during the first and the second, Aaron Peterson, our Next Steps director, she preached an incredible message on God is good. And today I want to jump into a message that is called Our God is Present. And you may be going through something right now where it is something that is unplanned. And so today I just want to make sure that you are encouraged to know that God is present in that moment. Husbands most likely will answer this. Raise your hand if you are sitting next to a crazy, and I mean crazy, planner person. The ones that have like a different color for every child in the family, a different highlighter for medical, for school, for PTA, they have it all. There's somebody on our staff and she knows who she is and I give her all the love, but she is a crazy planner person. And her planner is called the Happy Planner. And I think it's the stressed out planner. But Megan is that to our family. But one thing that I know that throws Megan off is whenever an interruption happens. One thing that happens every single night before I'm just about to close my eyes, and I'm probably already half asleep, is Megan says, "Babe," and she like slaps me, "Babe, what's on your plans for tomorrow?" And I think after 8 years that she would know that my answer is always gonna be, "No, you know, like I'm just gonna get up and I gotta go to work and like I'm gonna like do my thing." Her phrase is, "Well, I was thinking was that you could," and that proceeds to be like, "At 9 o'clock, I need you here. At 10 o'clock, there's a doctor's appointment that you have to take the kids to. This and that." And so she is that in our family, and I need that balance in my life. So I'm thankful for her. But I do know that interruptions can throw her for a loop and throw us for a loop. Things pop up, financial, health-related, loss of a loved one, marriage problems, work-related, and so on. Everybody's probably thinking of that one interruption in their life right now as I say those things. The Bible tells us, and we hear it in the song we just sang, the Bible tells us that no matter how much we plan for things, ultimately things happen that we don't plan for. In John 16, verse 33, it tells us, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." What does that mean? Our God is still on the throne. He is still good. He is still in control, and he has you. He is not surprised by that. And so I always lean on that when things start to get a little wobbly in the plans. I just know that, okay, God, you have warned me for this, but I know that you are still on the throne, and you are still God, and you are still good. The enemy wants nothing more than to catch you in your trouble or your interruption, unprepared, and let you feel hopeless in that moment. Am I right? Leaving you feeling ultimately like your Heavenly Father just isn't present. Well, today, if you're living in an interruption, something that you didn't plan for, I want to give you 3 tools to help you in that season of your life. And my point number one is you have to be bold. You have to be bold. And we learn of a woman today. We're going to dig into her story. It's in Luke, but this woman, her situation came up, her circumstance came up, and it didn't last for just a day. It didn't last for a week. We're going to learn that it lasted for 12 years. We read in Luke 8, 43, verse 43 through 48, and it says, "And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him, and she touched the edge of his cloak." And I want to stop right there. There's a comma, so we'll stop. And have you ever been in a situation where you literally wanted something so bad and it was in the grip of your hand, but then it slipped through? Anybody in here? Nod of heads? Yes, I see your hands. I wonder what she was feeling in that moment. In that moment, she needed to get Jesus' attention. She needed him to see her. Let me ask you this. How many of you have kids? Raise your hand if you got kids. Okay, now how many of your kids interrupt you? Please don't let me be alone. Okay, our kids interrupt us because they want us to be present in that exact moment so that we can hear or hear a story or whatever. Somebody's tattling on somebody. They want us to be present. Well, this happened this week. I didn't even have this in my message, but it happened on like Wednesday or Thursday. I get home, and we're just in this season. We have a 6, 5, and 3-year-old, so I need the prayers. But we are in this season where all of our kids are just like, mom, 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 dad, 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 dad. So, of course, we go to bed every night, and we're just like, we're horrible parents. We're probably ruining them. Like, we don't know how to do this. And so Megan has been listening to some parenting podcast, and she listened to one without me. And so I get home, and I'm standing in the kitchen talking to Megan, and all of a sudden, my middle child, Bo, comes up, and he's, like, trying really hard to, like, touch my shoulder. And I'm like, I don't know what he's doing. Like, this is just another weird Bo thing. And so Bo's trying to touch my shoulder, and Megan's eyes get really big. And I'm like, what's happening? Like, what's going on? And she's like, gets down. She's like, Bo, I'm so proud of you for touching Dad's shoulder and not interrupting. And she was like, babe, I'll catch you up in a minute. Like, but I listened to a podcast, and I taught the kids this new thing. And so it doesn't work with all the kids, though. And so Malin, my feisty one, she's 3, and if they can't reach your shoulder, they have to touch your elbow. So parents, take notes. Elbow, if they're short, tall, you hit the shoulder. So Malin comes in, and she's not even listening to the rules. She's just going at it, mom, 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 dad, dad, dad. And she's like, don't pay her attention. Don't pay her attention. Just keep looking at me. And then there's supposedly a signal that you do if your kid's not doing it right. And so this magical finger, you just spin it like this. Everybody spin your finger, because you're going to try it when you get home. All right, so Megan starts spinning her finger. I'm like, this just keeps getting weirder. Like, what is going on? And she said, do it, spin your finger. And I was like, so we're both in the kitchen spinning our fingers. And all of us, like, Malin is getting very furious at this point. She's not mad. She's past mad. She's bad, bad, mad. And so she looks, and she's like, oh, I'm not doing the elbow thing. And so she leans forward, touches both of our elbows. She's like, I need you. I need to talk to you. And so ultimately, they want to be present. They want us to be present in their needs. And I feel like this is what the woman in the story was feeling, is that she didn't just need to be in the crowd. She knew that she needed Jesus to see her. She knew that Jesus needed to stop and to be present. And we read on, and it gets good. We just stopped at the comma, but it gets better. So it says, and she came up behind him, and she touched the edge of his cloak. And immediately her bleeding stopped. Jesus says in verse 45, who touched me? And when they all denied it, Peter said, Master, the people are crowding up against you. But Jesus said, someone touched me. I know, because power has gone out from me. Then the woman, seeing that she could not be unnoticed anymore, she came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, Daughter, your faith has made you, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. So in that moment, how did this woman be bold? She took action. I can't imagine sitting in a condition or an ailment or an interruption for 12 years. She was considered an outcast by her society. She was considered unclean. She probably lived on the outskirts of town. She never probably went, and like, crowds were not something that she was drawn to. That was something that she would have been ridiculed for. But she was bold. She woke up one morning and she said, I know who can heal me. I know where he's going to be, and I know how to get him, and I believe that he has a miracle for me. And so she got up and she did just that. And in that moment where she thought she missed her chance, Jesus stopped, and he was present in the moment, and he found her in that crowd, and because of her faith, she was healed. Church, are you being bold in your moment of trouble? Are you being bold in your interruption today? Or are you being timid and an idle disposition? This is where depression and anxiety can come in. I've been depressed. I've been an anxious person before. And this is where the enemy will try to cripple us and say that you're not needed, you're not seen, nobody wants to see you. And of course, obviously, God doesn't want to even see you. That is a lie from the enemy. And so we have to push back against that lie today. And we need to be bold and boldly approach the one who we know can heal us today. Point number 2 is you have to remember. And someone who did this very well in the Bible was David. If David had antidepressants back in the day, we probably wouldn't have even had the book of Psalms. So I'm kind of glad that we do have Psalms though, but David has a history of stressing out really bad and then remembering all in the same breath, sometimes in the same story. The scripture that we're about to read, just to kind of set it up, this is kind of when Absalom, his son, is gaining popularity in the kingdom, and he's about to get to the point where he can overtake David as king. And so David knew that if they found him, that they would most likely kill him to make this happen sooner. And so, not his first time, but David fled, and he fled to the caves, and then we start to read here in Psalms 3, verses 1 through 6, and it says, "Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, 'God will not deliver him.' But you, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head, the one that I call out to the Lord. He answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and I sleep and I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear though tens of thousands assail me on every side." And the shift is what I want to focus on. There is a shift in verse 2 to verse 3. And he says, right at the end where he says, like, they're just basically saying, like, God, they're not going to deliver me. You're not going to deliver me from this. This is what they're saying. And if Pastor Adam was here, he would say this in verse 3. He says, but. There's a big but right in the middle of this verse. And he says, "But, Lord, you are my shield around me." David does this because he immediately takes his eye off of the interruption that is in his life, and he looks back to the one who has brought him through everything that he had been before. When we remember God's faithfulness and we remember the battles that he's brought us from, he will help and get us through the battles that we are facing today. David does this again when he is about to face Goliath, and in 1 Samuel 17:37, we read, and this is David again. He says, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And church, whether it is something that is small or it is a Goliath in your life that you are facing today, remember the faithfulness of God. Remember that, and he will be present in that moment, and it will change the battle. We have to change our mindset if we want to change and defeat the enemy's lies that he is trying to push at us. Point number 3, you have to be surrounded. Who are you surrounding yourself by? One of the biggest things that can catapult us to Jesus is the people that we choose to surround ourselves by, and we have full control over that. One of my favorite stories in the Bible that literally is the bookmark of friendship is in Mark, and just to kind of set this up, like, these four friends had a paralyzed friend, and they knew who could heal him. They knew he was in town. This is very similar to the first story. And they knew that he was going to be there. And so they said, "Well, you can't walk, but we know who can make you walk. So we're going to pick up your bed and literally take you to Jesus so that you can get your healing." I want friends like that around me that will carry me in a time of need. So they literally pick up their friend. We have no idea how far they walked, but they get to a house that they know Jesus is at. And what are they met with? They are met with people in the windows, people in the doors, people outside the house. The house is full. There is no way to get into this house. Do these friends just say, like, "All right, well, we're going to get him on the next stop on his tour. We'll just find out where he's going to be." Like, no. These friends, they literally said, "We are going to the roof. We are going to dig through the roof, and we're going to lower you through." Like, whoever, because you know there was just one guy that probably said that. Like, "I want that one guy." He was like, no. "If we go up this way, and we hop over here, and we pull him up here, we could probably lower him. And then who has a shovel? Anybody bring a shovel?" Because then it was like dirt, mud, thatch, palms, everything, reeds, everything. And so you actually had to perform the act of digging to get into the roof. And so Jesus is inside this house preaching. And I can't imagine preaching. Like, if literally dirt and, like, debris started falling on my head right now, I would probably stop, and we would probably vacate the building because there's a big rat up there or something. But they lower the man through the roof. And it tells us in Mark 2, verse 5, and it says, "When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.'" I don't think these friends had a plan B. I don't think they ever once thought that they were going to have to do the task of pulling him back up through the roof. I think they knew full well that he was going to get healed and that he was going to walk out that door that day. It was because of their faith. and who is surrounding you, it may not be, church, listen to this. I think this is so important. It may not be just your faith and just your prayers that's going to get you out of the situation that you're in right now. It may be the joining of those who surround you's prayers that are going to join up with yours that's going to bring you your deliverance out of the circumstance that you're in. I always thought it would be cool. This is one of those things, like, Megan always says I start stuff and then, like, I don't, like, do it all the way. But I bought this one line a day journal about 3 years ago. And there's, like, you can see basically on each page, like, what was I doing 5 years ago on this day, like, with one verse or with one sentence? And I put, like, two or three entries in it. It's still sitting on my desk. I really should start doing it. But I always thought it would be cool if everybody was, like, mandated to write a chapter in, like, our book of, like, life or whatever. But at New Year's Eve, if you were just forced to sit down and just write a journal entry of, like, what was the year like for you? And I started thinking, and I was like, man, like, not a ton of my plans would make my like, journal entry. Like, it was all of the interruptions. Maybe it was whenever Malin broke her arm. Like, that would make the interruption. Maybe when I had to have my appendix taken out. Like, that was definitely an interruption. Or when I lost my grandpa. Like, there are so many things that I was just going through, and I was just like, man, the interruptions made the book. And then the Lord just so gently just told me, he was like, Greg, like, that's the Bible. How many times was Jesus on his way to preach to the disciples, and he was interrupted? We don't know what the message was that day in the house, but the story, the interruption made that story. Whenever Jesus was at the wedding and the wine ran out, he filled the wine buckets. That was an interruption. The boy with the fish and the loaves, it was an interruption. When the woman bust down the door, the prostitute, and to barge in on Jesus' dinner because she knew who could heal her and forgive her of her sins, like, that was an interruption. The storm on the sea, that was an interruption. And so wherever you're at today in your life, know that Jesus is with you, that the interruptions, God is there. And as the band makes their way up, I just want to close with this. I was putting my daughter to bed a few months ago. This was before I even knew that I was going to be preaching on this. But Malin, she's like our best bedtime baby. Like, she still goes to bed at 6:30. Thank you, Jesus. And she goes to bed by herself, and she doesn't come out until the morning. But one of the things that we do in our routine is we have Alexa in the room, and Malin, by now, she says, Alexa, play worship music. And Alexa will sometimes start to play, but sometimes it's streaming on another device, and it's like, do you want to stream from here instead? And Malin says, yes, of course. And so Alexa will start the shuffle list of worship songs. And one of these songs came on, and it was We Bow Down. We lay our crown at the feet of Jesus, that old song. And I knew it, but I didn't know how many times it has come on shuffle for her to know it. And the song came on, and where it gets to the part where it says, holy, 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 we cry holy, 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 Malin, like, so confidently, she just says, hold me, hold me, hold me. And there's certain times in your walk with Christ that you just have these moments where the Lord just shows you a glimpse of his character. And in that moment was one of those moments for me. And as a dad and as a parent, I feel like you can relate. Like, I was like, man, like, our God is holy, and he is so holy and righteous and deserving of all of our praise. But on the other hand, like, he so desperately just wants to hold us and be with us. And I was just thinking, like, those parental instincts that I have towards my kids, the ones that I want to hold them whenever they're hurt, whenever they get bullied at school and I just want to wrap them up. Like, that is our Father. So, church, as we stand up today and as we get ready to sing this last song, you guys can go ahead and stand. Like, I want you to know, whatever interruption you guys are in, it may not be in your plans, but our Heavenly Father is in them. He is so good, and he wants to meet you right where you're at. And so today, that is my prayer for you guys.
Thanks for watching today. If you'd like to continue the conversation, you can like us on Facebook or follow us on Instagram. If our church has had an impact on you and you'd like to support all that Jesus is doing in this place, you can do so by going to rise-church.com/give and select the giving option that best suits you. Thanks so much for joining us online, and we hope you have a blessed week.